Praise God, saints. We greet you. It's been 9 weeks under quarantine, and you know, we need more prayer now than ever before. This is Pastor Thornton, greeting all the saints. Looking forward to the time that we can get together in our place of worship and just begin to rejoice. Just the seeing of one another will bring great joy to all of us. Times seem to be getting even worse now. Last week I told you about two of my grandchildren that were exposed to danger because of the volatile nature of some of these demonstrations. They say there are a lot of people that are there for different reasons, and you know, we see a lot of violence. And matter of fact, I want to pray for a couple of people. I want to pray for a friend of my daughter Robin and her husband Carl. His name is William. He's head of security, and he was injured. And I want to pray for their friend Tanya, a member of their church. So we'll start with a word of prayer. Father, we come now in the name of Jesus, and Lord God, we're with heavy hearts, and we're concerned for the nation, for America, the United States of America. There's a perfect storm has come together. While we were quarantined and under a stay-at-home order because of COVID-19, and many people were beginning to suffer from cabin fever, and at that time, during that time, there have been two terrible situations that have developed. Two innocent black men, two unarmed innocent black men that were murdered. There was a man by the name of Ahmaud Arbery down in Georgia. He was chased, stalked, and murdered. And these things are on video. And then there was George Floyd, a police officer who stopped him for a bogus reason, got so violent with him, he kneeled on his neck and cut off his air supply, and he died. And this has caused great rage in our area and throughout the nation, across the nation. So it's a perfect storm that has come together and created this anger and violence in the nation. We want to pray for the protesters, because the protesters at some point have to be able to separate themselves from the violent anarchists. And we pray that God will give somebody wisdom. Thank God for the demonstrations of Martin Luther King. He made it clear that he was not going to allow extreme left-wing anarchists to hijack his movement and his demonstrations. Let's pray that something of that nature will happen in this case. Let's look to the Lord and ask God's prayer, ask God's blessings, you know, on all the young people that are out there in the streets, and pray for the police. I was told that the 75 police officers of the Buffalo Police Department have resigned, and you know, we need the police. So we don't know where this is going, but God, you know. Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask you, Lord God, to just stir up the hearts of the saints, stir up the hearts of your people, that they would begin to just pray for the chaos and confusion that's in the land and the people that are caught up. Lord God, but let your people always remember who it is in whom we have believed. We know, Lord God, that You are Lord of all, you are over all, and you have all things under control. We pray, Lord God, for a woman named Tanya. We pray for William Bond, Chief of Security. Lord, we ask, Lord God, that you would have mercy on your people. Lord, William Bond and Tanya are your children. They're Christians, and we pray for them because they are our brother and sister. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Last week, we were on the same subject. You know, we were talking about the new covenant. Are you a new covenant saint? Are you a New Testament Christian? Think about that. We're going to start with a scripture that's going to put more emphasis on the fact that we are under a new covenant and that Jesus Christ himself is the mediator of this new covenant. In your Bibles, in the 8th chapter of Hebrews, and I'll start reading at the 5th verse, and in the 5th verse it says that Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. It says, God said, "See, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern shewed to thee in the mount." In verse 6, but now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant. So we know that this new covenant is a better covenant than any covenant that preceded it. And this is the covenant that we're under. As born-again Christians, we're under this new covenant, and Jesus is the mediator of the new covenant. As it says in this 6th verse of the 8th chapter of Hebrews, it says, "But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with them, he saith, Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant. And I regarded them not, saith the Lord." Verse 10, "For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their heart. And I will be to them a God, and they shall be my people." What God is saying here is that under this new covenant, of which Jesus Christ is the mediator, Jesus Christ, our Lord, is the mediator of this new covenant that we are under. And this covenant was signed in his own blood. But under this new covenant, God is simply saying that I'm going to raise up a people under this covenant that will have a heart to obey. That's what it means when he says in verse 10, "For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind." This is God speaking. "I will put my word, I will put my law into their mind and write them in their hearts." So God is simply saying, I'm going to raise up a people that I'm going to install obedience. I'm going to install a love for my word. They will have a love for the word of God, and they will have a mind to obey the word of God. So this is why we were using 1 John, the second chapter, the third through the sixth verse, amen, as sort of an all-around theme that says, this is how you know that you are part of this new covenant. As New Testament saints, we are saying that we are under this new covenant, and the new covenant is described in the book of Hebrews and says that the new covenant will be a covenant that God will make, that when we become born again, when we are born of His Spirit, when you're born again, you're born of the Spirit of God. You are quickened, you are touched by the Spirit of God. And God says that I will put a spirit in you that will give you the capacity and the ability and the desire to be obedient to the Word of God. And that's why we refer to 1 John, the second chapter, 3rd through the 6th verse, that says, hereby know we that we are in Him. This is how we know that we know Him. Hereby know we that we know Him. So, ask yourself, am I a New Testament Christian? Am I truly born again? If you're born again, you're under the new covenant. Am I under the new covenant? Look at another scripture in Hebrews. Hebrews, the 9th chapter and the 14th verse. Well, let's go to the 13th verse. It says, for if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh. That's making a reference to the old system under the old covenant in the Old Testament. It says, for if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered Himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? How much shall the blood of Jesus purge your dead conscience so that you can serve the living God? It's under this covenant, God says, I will give you a capacity for obedience. I will give you a love for my word, a love for my commandment, a love for my instructions. You will have a desire to do my will. We can't do God's work if we're not willing to do His will, if we're not willing to be obedient to Him. But God says that He will install a capacity for obedience. I'll read that 14 verses again. It says, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit, how much shall the blood of Christ, who through the Holy Spirit, here we have the blood of Christ, and the blood is offered through the power of the Holy Spirit, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered Himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? God says, I'm going to fix them up and make them so that they can serve God. They can live right. They can walk right. They can do the will of God. They can please God. I don't know where this doctrine and teaching in many of our churches comes from that says that we can't live right. We can't please God. Nobody can please God. Nobody's perfect. And we see in the Old Testament, as I said before, under other covenants that were not as powerful as this covenant. Under other covenants, people have been able to please God. In Job, the first chapter and the 8th verse, it says, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was perfect and upright. and one that feared God and eschewed evil. And then in Genesis, the 6th chapter, the 9th verse, God speaking about Noah, it says, Noah was a just man and perfect. That's what the Bible says. That's what the Bible says. That's what God said. God said that Job was perfect. God said that Noah was perfect. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generation, and Noah walked with God. In Genesis, the 7th chapter, in the 1st verse, you find these words, God speaking to Noah, God says, thee have I seen righteous before me. That's what God says. God says, you have been righteous in my sight. And then there was Enoch. We know that the Bible says that before Enoch was translated, he had this testimony that he pleased God. These men did not do these things in human strength. It was by the power of the Holy Spirit. And God is saying that under the new covenant, every one of his children that come through him, through the blood of Jesus, every one of his children who confess their sins and repent of their sins and ask God for mercy and becomes a born-again Christian, God says that he will put his spirit in them, give them a love for his word, and give them a proclivity to walk in obedience. And that's why we read the scripture over in 1 John, the 2nd chapter, 3rd to the 6th verse. It says, hereby know we that we are in him. In other words, it's saying, this is how you know that you know the Lord. This is how you can be sure that's what the Bible says. Amen. Hereby know we that we are in him. Jesus said in John, the 14th chapter, he that hath my commandment and keepeth them, he it is that loves me. And he that loves me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him, and will manifest myself unto him. Then there was Daniel. The Bible says that Daniel was a man that was greatly beloved by God. Daniel prayed and prayed until God sent an archangel to answer his prayers. And God told him that his prayer had been answered. Then there was John the Baptist, that Jesus said, of those born of a woman, there's none greater than John the Baptist. The Bible says John the Baptist received the Holy Ghost while he was in his mother's womb. Why did God do that? God did that because God wanted John to have the power to live right. And those of us who are born again, we are born of God's Spirit. In this New Testament period, we are born of God's Spirit. We have a scripture that we all love in the New Testament. Everybody loves to quote it. They quote it all the time. But I wonder how many people actually believe it. And the scripture is found in Philippians 4:13, which says, I can do all things through Christ. In other words, it's saying, I can do all things through the anointing. Christ means the anointed or the anointing. I can do all things through the anointing of God. I can do all things by the power of God's Holy Spirit. Isn't that wonderful? Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ, which does what? Strengthens me. Gives me the power. Enables me to do the will of God. Enables me to walk before God. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Then another scripture in 1 John 4:4 says, greater is he that is in us, or greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. You have the Spirit of God. You have the Holy Ghost in you. That's what we mean when we say that Christ in me is the hope of glory. Christ in me is the hope. And so how do we know that we have received this blessing, this gift, this power? 1 John 2, verses 3 through 6. This is how we know that we know him. If we keep his commandment. He that hath my commandment and keepeth them, he it is that loves me. I want to read that scripture in 1 John because I want to read all of it and go even down a little further. I'll start at the third verse, 1 John, the second chapter, and 1 John, the second chapter, and starting at the third verse. It says, hereby, I'm going to keep repeating this over. My job is to give you the word of God because, see, it's the word of God that's going to break every yoke. It's the word of God that'll set you free. It's the word of God that will empower you to become a true son of God. And hereby we do know that we know him. If we keep his commandment, he that saith, I know him. This puts a lot of people in a bad light. A lot of people always going around saying, I know the Lord. I know the Lord. I'm walking with the Lord. People who won't live right, can't live right. People that are walking in sins that the Bible says are an abomination before God, but they want to tell you that I'm a born-again Christian. I'm a child of God. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar. And the truth is not in him. But whoso keeps his word, in him truly is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. In other words, it's saying, this is how we know that we are in him. If you have that hunger and thirst for righteousness, if you have that hunger and thirst for the word, if God's word is the delight of your heart, the psalmist said, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. Praise the Lord. Amen. And even the words of the benediction that we like to use, which it's near time to use the benediction. But before we go to that, I just want to give you one more scripture over in the fifth chapter of 1 John. First John, the fifth chapter, and the third verse says, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. In other words, if you love God, that's what Jesus said. Jesus said, if you have my commandment and you keep my commandment, you're the one who loves me. And here's saying the same thing. In 1 John 5, 3, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. In other words, you don't find it to be grievous to do the will of God, to obey God. You know, people can obey whoever they want to obey. People can obey whoever they make up their mind they're going to obey. People try to make you think that obedience is an impossibility, especially obeying the will of God. The will of God, who has nothing but love for you. God's word will guide you in the right way. God's word will cause you to be an overcomer. God's word will cause you to walk in victory, will give you victory over every sin and every evil and all the wickedness of this present world. The word of God, all we have to do is obey the word, follow the instructions of the word of God. Amen. It's truly now time for me to refer to the benediction because the benediction is part of the message. The benediction is found in Ephesians 3:20. It says, now unto him which is able to do exceeding and abundantly above all that we ask or think. God is able to make you live like Noah. God is able to make you live like Job. God is able to make you to live like John the Baptist. Just like it says over in 1 John, the third chapter, which we were going to read straight down to that, and I think I better do that. I'm going back to 1 John, the second chapter. But whoso keeps his word, in him truly is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. He that saith he abides in him ought himself also so to walk even as he walked. Amen. And then in 1 John the 3rd chapter, it says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knows us not. The world doesn't understand us. And the world will even try to tell us that we can't live that life. You can't, nobody can live the holy lifestyle. Nobody can live by the word of God. Nobody can have victory over sin. Jesus died so that you can have victory over sin. Amen. The Bible says that we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. It says here in 1 John 3rd chapter, and first verse, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knows us not because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And then the third verse says, and every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. And then our final benediction, we already gave you one benediction, another. Nowadays, in these perilous times that we're living in, you need two benedictions. These are some rough times. The Bible says in the last days, perilous times shall come. Jesus said that. In the last days, perilous times shall come. The Bible says in the world you shall have tribulation. That's what's happening in the world. Tribulation. But be of good courage. Jesus said, I have overcome the world and we abide in him. Amen. In Jude the 24th verse says, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling. Do you believe that? Do you believe the word of God? Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you what? Faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. You can do all things through the power of the Holy Ghost, through the power of God's Holy Spirit. My beloved brother and sister, put your trust in the Word of God. Ask God to give you that new heart if you have not received it. Ask God to touch you and give you that new heart. Give me a heart to obey. Give me a heart to do right. Give me a heart to please God. Father, in Jesus' name, bless my brothers and sisters. Let your anointing rest on your children, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and delivered me from every fear. Those who look on him are radiant. They'll never be ashamed. They'll never be ashamed. This glory.